let's start. It's 12:15 now. Thanks for coming again. Today we actually have Pi Rui, right? He's one of the, I think, I'm looking for the word, not fiercest, but most passionate about startup, right? And he's actually helping to run the PSA UnBoxed Corporate Accelerator, right? And also VC Fund. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to let him explain what PSA UnBoxed is all about, and then after that we will do some Q&A. Take it away, Pi Rui. Thank you.
Hi everyone, I'm Pi Rui. I'm from PSA UnBoxed, and I'm here to share with you how your company or startup can be relevant to us and how we can help you grow. So a bit of history. We are 100% wholly owned subsidiary of PSA International, and your first takeaway today is that PSA doesn't stand for anything. It is not an acronym. We were part of Singapore Authority in the 1970s, and in 1997 we decided to corporatize. So we split the two. MPA is now the regulatory body, and PSA is simply the port operator. We kept the brand name PSA, but it just is PSA. So we're the largest port operator group by equity weighted throughput. We handle about 10% of the global container throughput. In 2016, that comes up to 68 million TEUs thereabouts. And we have 40 terminals in 16 different countries. So as you can see, these are where our ports are located. We are concentrated mainly in Asia because of the intra-Asia trade, which is the strongest trade route in the world, and along the Far East Europe route, which is the third. So a good question is, what is the second busiest trade route in the world, the Trans-Pacific, from Asia to America? Our flagship terminal is, of course, Singapore. We handle about half of the volume of the entire group. Last year, it was 30.6 million TEUs. A TEU is a 20-foot equivalent unit, which is the standard measurement in our industry for how much volume. So a 20-foot container is one TEU, a 40-foot container is two TEUs, and so forth. PSA Singapore handles about 1/7 of the entire transshipment throughput in the world. What transshipment is basically the containers don't enter Singapore. They come here and we do a switch for them. They go onto a different ship. So that's what we do. And we have about 70 different sailings out of Singapore every day. So we have excellent connectivity. So that's a quick introduction of my parent company. I'm from PSA UnBoxed. We are the corporate venture capital arm of PSA International. Mm-hmm. And we are looking to harness innovation from the startup ecosystem. So within PSA, we've always had very strong innovation programs working within PSA and also with our vendors and customers. But we realized that with the vibrancy of the startup community, we were neglecting that. And therefore, last year, on the 5th of May, we set up PSA UnBoxed. Tap on that. Being a corporate venture capital, we have to invest in startups that are strategic to our business, and we've broken it down to two focus areas. First is port technology. It's not just cranes and trucks. Port technology is basically anything that helps us move containers faster to bring value to our customers, safer for our workers, and more efficient for PSA, which is really our strong selling point. So anything out of that, not container movement, but do with trade and logistics, for example, trade finance or compliance tracking for documents submitted for trade. We're also interested in looking at that. So really, if you have a company or startup or an idea that can enable this, please come and speak to us. So I'm going to elaborate on what port technology is. On the 3rd of March this year, we launched our call for action 2, and the key theme was Container Port 4.0. Container Port 4.0 is really an evolving document of what we think the port of the future will look like. So it's not cast in stone. We just identified several areas that will feature in the port of the future. We have 60 prompts, and let me dwell a bit on them. The first of which is automation and robotics. Container movement by crane and by truck within the terminal are slowly being automated. Trucks are now driverless in what we use what we call AGVs, automated guided vehicles, to move trucks along. Robotics is another part that we think will feature in the port of the future. A lot of the the heat back into offices and more comfortable environments. A connected community, in the future, data will be shared more freely. We termed it hyper-connected port. So regulatory bodies, our shippers, ourselves, we envision more collaborative information sharing so that, you know, if you submit it to PSA, you don't have to submit it to MPA or vice versa. The kind of information flow, we think that it will allow a lot more collaboration and efficiency for all the stakeholders in the logistics industry. Preemptive HFS management is health and safety and security. As you can imagine, security, including cybersecurity, the port is very critical. We put preemptive in front of that is because in the future, when we move towards a more automated environment, some areas where there are automated vehicles moving, we will not have human eyes on the ground. So if I have a customer or a supplier coming down and supposed to enter that area, I will need to have checks in place to ensure that it's going to the right place where there are no operations, rather than accidentally go into a place where there's automated operations, which will be dangerous. So in the future, the automated terminal, we envision, will be covered with cameras all around, with data analytics and visual analytics. We want to preempt accidents before they happen, rather than mitigation. We hope to stop them before it happens. Environmental sustainability, pretty self-explanatory, but in the port specifically, we have huge amounts of very heavy equipment and cargo being moved around. So we're looking at ways where we can generate and regenerate clean energy from these container movements. Of course, reducing consumables and materials in the port or recycling them is also another key area that we're looking at. Smart machines and systems, it's not the same as automation and robotics. A smart machine would be, for example, now I'm a crane. In the future, I hope my crane will be smart enough to tell me, hey, I need this part replaced in 2 weeks' time, or due to this week's very intensive operations, I will need an oil change before the scheduled maintenance. So that's something we hope our machines can operate at. Integrated and optimized port operations. Right now, like I said before, PSA has a very strong high efficiency rate. We're hoping to sustain that and improve on that as we move into data analytics and the ability to fuse that to make data-driven decisions to maintain and sustain the high levels of productivity. So really, these are the six areas that we envision the port of the future. And if you have an idea or solution or a company that enables this, please come and speak to us. We'll be more than happy. So why container port 4.0? What's wrong with our current port? Nothing's wrong with our current port, just that we like to look for it. Right now, we are reclaiming and building a port in Quartz. It will be the largest port in the world. Estimated to take 3 years from start to finish. There will be over 26 kilometers of key length, to give you a sense of scale. 66 berth to 65 million TU annual capacity. So it'll be a massive operation. Compared to where we are currently, we have 57 berths and 17 kilometers of berth length. Our area is now around 700 hectares, and the annual capacity is around 40 to 45 million. So really, Quartz will be a huge project, and it will be one of the beneficiaries of Container Port 4.0. But like I said, we have 40 terminals in different countries, so really, as this evolves, we have that capability to improve across the board. So as a CDC, we run an incubation program with four features. The first is a pre-seed level investment in exchange for a small equity stake. I think that's pretty standard. But what we provide really is the free policy of mentorship by domain experts within our industry, so several heads of divisions and key personnel that are able to provide insight into the logistics industry will be mentoring some of our startups. We also have external mentors such as Mr. Chuck Kong Tsu from Stream, who will be able to provide value on how to fundraise, what is the next funding round, your business plan, so on and so forth. We provide a co-working space for entrepreneurs, rent-free, of course, where it is startups have an interest in entering the LogTech community but have no inroad or are unsure if their technology can apply in port, we're happy to share ideas with them. Proof of concept and feasibility studies, if you have a technology you're unsure if your work has a lot of metal interference and so forth, we're happy to provide you with a certain scope to work with and grow with you. Mutual referrals of staff or investments, I think is really, you know, we fund at a pre-seed level. If you have a following, if you fund at a higher level, we're happy to refer startups and vice versa. Technology transfer across industries is really interesting. If you have a solution that is already in place, but perhaps not in the logistics industry, we're happy to work with you to see whether that solution can be brought into our environment. And last but not least, we try to cultivate interest and nurture talent in the LogTech industry. We work with NUS Engineering, Venture, and several other universities to really bring talent and nurture interest in the logistics sector in Singapore. So if you're not sure if any of this applies to you, please drop me an email and we'll be happy to work it through with you. Come to the end, and I open the floor to questions, please. At the moment, we have funded two startups. We're incubating them currently. One is to do with digitizing freight bookings, and the other is to do with how we can use simultaneous localization mapping technology to navigate our AGVs. So they are not under incubation, not specifically, but we have made an investment in Clear Metal, which is a Silicon Valley-based startup. What they do is predictive analysis for container movement, cargo flow. Their engine runs on AI and it runs on an AI algo with some other features. I'm sorry, can't think off the top of my head. So we don't incubate them, but we have invested in them. Thank you.
This is pertaining to mostly container movements within the port. How about if there's an international trade?
Yes, that will fall under our adjacent space, which we are interested in. So port technology is anything to do with container movement within the port, but container movement outside of port or just uncontainerized trade outside of the port, we're also interested in. For example, trade finance and so on, that kind of stuff.
So more into the example, I'm into more into trying to ensure from the documentation perspective to reduce fraud and stuff like that.
Yes.
Have we needed in the case of
Yes, we actually just received an application for how blockchain can be used for document verification on it. So, yes, you know, definitely. Thank you.
How long is the incubation?
Our incubation is 3 to 9 months, depending on the level of technology readiness level of the startup and what they hope to achieve. But we're open. So what happens after you apply, we will match you with a mentor, and the startup and the mentor work together to decide what is a meaningful period to incubate with PSA. How much value can we bring in after that? You need to grow and scale, perhaps. Whether you need to be incubated or not, it's up to the startup.
No,
so
it
3 to 9.
It also depends on what is the initial investment you're going to give for the incubation company. Especially in the case of Singapore, the manpower cost is so expensive.
Yeah.
And if you are waiting too long, there's very short investment.
Yeah.
90% of the company is because of the cash flow.
Yes.
And it's nothing to do with the idea, nothing with the people, you do the cash flow.
Yep.
So there's no cash flow coming in. You own that beautiful office rent.
Yep. So that's why we provide the beautiful office rent free for you to work, and that helps the starts a bit. And for cash flow, that's where we have Mr. Chuck Pong soon to come in and tell you how to do fundraising.
I'm not a cash flow expert.
How about the living land? If we can explain what stuff can we do there, what some of the cool stuff that are possible within the living
the interesting thing about them is they're from three different companies and they run on slightly different programs. So really, it's not just to put the AGV there and do operations, it's really to test it out and see what the difference is. So like I said, one of our startup, Water Sense, is looking to see how they can use LiDARs to navigate the AGV rather than right now, AGVs run on RFID tags implanted on the ground. So the AGV moves, it pings, it sort of navigates. So, which is very costly, high maintenance, because you have to drill and put the RFID into the ground. So, AutoSense, one of our incubators, is looking to see how we can remove that completely, the markerless AGVs. So, that's one of the programs that are going on there now. We're talking to another company about a personnel tracking solution. Like I said, we're surrounded by containers and port, huge amounts of metal. So how can you track your personnel to make sure that they are safe? It's another thing we're looking at. So ultra wideband solutions, we're looking to have a pilot trial within the living lab.
Many of these projects you're talking about involves a fair amount of hardware investment. And so it's actually, what you're doing is very different from a software startup. Because it's very physical.
So
you know, usually for those kind of startups, right, they need a lot more money because they have to make stuff.
This is the last. So with AutoSense, I can't ask you to buy an AGV, like cost several million. And the LiDARs, which are basically radars based on light, are really expensive, from anywhere from 10 to 20 K. So we have very kindly provided him with the AGV and the LiDARs for that, but of course it's dependent on the type of project that we're incubating. So right now we have one hardware and one software company, and depending on what they need, we will work with them to see how we can best bring value to them.
Well, it also helps to understand what is our end game plan. Because incubation is a great thing. There's so many incubation happening nowadays.
Yep.
But incubation is not the end game. After some time, what is the level of investment you're going to commit? That is important. You're not going to pay 200K, whatever the initial amount you pay. There's only sustain for some distance and travel. They should not stop there.
Yes.
What is your value at day from that point?
Maybe what we can do is that we can go to a Q&A, a more interactive portion of the section, right? So maybe what we can do is that we can walk through, right, a startup that says, you know, okay, I'm interested in the PSA program. Right? How do we go about and what are the advantages, right? So the first step is probably going to the website to look at what are the common statements that PSA and Box are looking at. So it's very pod centric.
The six items are very good.
The six items, right? But I think within this embedded six items, there's also some blue sky opportunity.
Yes.
Right? Meaning that, you know, if there's an opportunity that goes beyond, right, but it's still of some use or some opportunity with the PSA, right, they will also incubate. The reason why is this, right? One of the biggest advantage of PSA is that they actually have PSA to test your system before you go out. So therefore, like the LiDAR example, right, because they need it, right? So the question then is that there are already equipment there, what else equipment you would require, if you're interested, then they will provide. And of course, once it is proved that, you know, there is use in the organization, right, they have another 40 something ports, right?
Yeah,
40 ports that they could actually export to,
scale.
Right, they can scale, right? And then they would actually put in more money, right? The caution I have for them is not to buy the company, because they would love to buy the company, right, as PSA, right? And they could afford it, right? The question is that, you know, can they actually let this guy run a little bit more, right, before completely taking over? That is a separate issue altogether, if it works, right? So the first thing that the company should do is to either pay a visit to Pi Rui or Moyen,
yes,
right, the team over there, right? And then maybe what you do is you walk through, what do you guys do with them? Right, if I come to you with this proposal, you guys will take it apart?
So generally, either emails or online on the website, people apply and contact us. And what we do is we we meet up, we understand the solution, and we work with them to see if it has to be tweaked to be used in a pod or whether it can be used in a pod directly. And we work with them to see how we can bring value to them if they come on board. Then what we do is we go through several key points and we structure it in a way that makes sense to both sides. Why would they want to incubate with us and why would we want to invest in them? And then we take them through an incubation process. We explain to them.
Before the incubation progress, in the thought process, what you guys do, correct me if I'm wrong, right, is you guys already looking up at whole pod operation out there, and they have actually mentors from every department of PSA.
Division
of PSA, right? And basically, they are in their mind, they are already thinking who could be the mentor from internally, and who could be the mentor externally, right? So that's the process you guys go through. If there is a match of requirement and potential, right, for that.
That's absolutely right. Yeah.
So it is basically more than just the incubation process. The thinking process already put into place, you know, some of this mindset and thoughts, right? Then after that, there is one or two presentations, right?
Yes.
How does that go?
Once you're
shortlisted.
Yeah, once you're shortlisted, we run through with the PSA UnBoxed mentors to see if there are any points that, any applications that you can have in the pod that we have not thought about. So we'll bake it even more, and then we'll invite you to come there, come to pitch. You'll be pitching in front of a panel of mentors, including Chuck, and we'll see how good your idea is and whether there is a good collaboration that can come from it.
And from the experience, right, it's a very different pitch because it's a combination of mentors and potential user of your technology. Right? So they actually ask very specific questions, right? And therefore, your startup has to be quite sharpened in what you want to do. Now, not that it will make or break, right? Because they also know that it's still a startup, right? So they will guide you and say, okay, maybe this one, you know, not practical. What have you thought of this, you know? So it's more, a pitch as well as information flowing to the guys. So it's not just,
go ahead and finish.
Yeah, so that was really my point, that they would take both ways.
You know, my problem is that I know zero about your business, right?
Yes.
And then we talk to me about pork and tell you about this one, right? but I think we're doing some interesting things. So I'm focusing back. And we're doing like AI machine learning to predict fraud, right? So like money laundering, prison financing, and corruption, taxation, scams. And so, since my question is, you know, are there similar things around that? And then what can, you know, the work that I'm doing now, the algorithms and then, you know, the data, the transactions, as we train the model, right, how much of that is portable to your business? And that can be leveraged. That kind of
Joe, maybe your question can be taken off.
But it could be like a general, you know, you don't have to be specific to that, right? I mean, I guess, you know, some of us don't know much about ports or logistics, right?
Yeah.
So, but we know about, you know, encryption or security, right?
So basically what they would do is to map that sixth area, right, that you mentioned, right, and see whether is there any rough fit, right? If there is, and you don't have to do, you know, all the way to do it, right?
And then you will massage it, right?
Yeah, they would then see whether is it doable. And they would actually validate with their mentors, which are the business user, right? And they say, okay, this one, don't try, we tried before, don't work. Or this one, hey, interesting, right? So then from there, they would help you craft out your pitch, right? Because they know what their site is looking for, and then you get to see those guys. Correct me if I'm wrong.
That is absolutely correct.
Because I've been involved one or two of their sessions, so I know how they work. From that perspective,
I think it's also good that, you know, the validation is good, so the users know that these guys are doing it so that they can support better and better.
Yes.
Right, cannot fail, basically.
Yeah. So from the guy's standpoint, okay, So right after you say you they accepted, right? There's a contract, you sign, there's some money, there's some space. What next?
So then we'll work with you either on a day-to-day basis, because you work in the same office, and we'll provide as much information to help you grow as much as possible. For example, we connect our freight forwarder company with all of our contacts, shipping lines, as well as our own district park distributors, and try to bring value to them, because naturally we know stakeholders in the field, and they are either users or customers that they can help us out. So really, along the way, we help them, we provide mentorship, we provide insight to what needs to be tweaked, what will work, what we think won't work, and help them all along the way. So basically, all along the incubation program, it is not structured like I can only see you once a week for 1 hour. Anytime, our doors are open, and we ideate with them all the time.
I have a question.
Sure.
Taking an example, many a times, entrepreneur, very much interested in this business, but anybody inside the organization, can you pull somebody also as a team member? Not a mentor, team member of the startup. Is possible.
It's not
a difficult question, I tell
yes,
you why.
It's
you know what it happens, 80% of the time, the entrepreneurship is a combination of complementary skills, and Ford is so specific, so domain oriented. Not many guys working at Ford, but the one working with Ford, they're only coming out. Because they are the one, they are managing the 40 ports, they go around there. So we can pull some people to make a team, then success will be very high.
Mm. It's a very fair point because of the domain expertise that our staff have. And I cannot commit any resources like that. I can definitely tell you that even if they're not a mentor, we match staffs meet with relevant members of our organization, help them with IDA.
Because you know what happens, mentor, skin in the game is small.
Hmm.
The guy who joined as a team member, skin in the game is high.
Yeah, the issue with that is because PSA pay for the manpower. So therefore it's difficult for them to say, hey, you're going to do something else. But from a mentor perspective, right, so I'm paired up with another gentleman who is in. This is my real experience, right? He's actually a mentor for PSA, right? So both of us actually mentor this organization that has been assigned to us, right? And because they are a corporate accelerator, right? I get consistent report every few period what exactly the guy is doing, even though I don't get a chance to meet the guy. That's what they do, right? And when we meet up, right, the mentor that is on the PSA side will say, okay, are you ready to see my Jakarta board? Right, if they are, when? And he will go with you to Jakarta and introduce you to the guys in Jakarta or wherever, you know, that they think that the business is ready for you. And that's the level of commitment I think PSA UnBoxed is getting, right, from the business side. Which I have not seen from any
corporatism
accelerator at this particular point in time. You know, they're all different type of corporate accelerators, and they're all successful different, you know, degrees, right? But the PSA, in my view, is a very operational and very business focus. Right? Correct me if I'm wrong, right? Because I think I've been getting those reports, and they actually spell out to me. This month, this guy did what? What's the objective? How has he told us that he's going to do this? Have he hit it? If not, why? Right? It's not about good or bad, it's just whether what has transpired. Right? Because, you know, for startup, environment change, right? So they actually keep track on the changes, right? To actually try to help the guy succeed. Right? I think that's just, I think, the difference between this accelerator, corporate accelerator, and the different ones. So there are different ones, like you said, you know, you put stuff in, you do different things, you know, right? But in the end, they will still decide whether what is the success level, right? So for them, the success level is actually, can they get, you know, the new startup into the business? I don't think it's a KPI, but I think it's something that they are consciously looking at. And that's where the value add is for PSA. There's 40 other ports out there. If they can replicate here, can they go somewhere else? And if you think about it on the other side, right, the company is looking for the next generation. They want to participate in the next generation growth, right? Is there any
Yes. It's very domain specific, and I'm afraid one of my point is if a company is going to be very successful, you might as well acquire it and ask the guys to come and work for you. So in a way, it is. I mean, corporate incubators always have this problem because it might look like I'm giving away 5% equity, but technically, I'm actually effectively giving away everything.
That is the point which I'm trying to help them very hard, right? To say, please don't buy over. Mm-hmm.
Because I have seen experience. One was corporate. Not a accelerator or anything, but I'm working with a corporation. They looked at it very differently. They want to buy the IP now. Because the product is successful now. So that is how it happens.
Because you become too successful, the startup might become too expensive. So you might as well reserve. And you, in a way, can cut off the startup by saying you don't have access to the code. So they basically screwed.
Yeah.
At some point, you can say like, if you are not going to be acquired, you don't have access to PSA port, and that basically cuts the company off completely.
But I think that's a fair point. But I think over the last how many years, there's some changes in PSA, and they're slightly more open, in my view, than in the past. I mean, I look at what the guys are doing, right? You guys are getting teams to do work with PSA. You know, in a hackathon, we are getting actually teams from PSA to actually integrate into the new environment. I mean, I think as a corporate, they also understand that they have to move on, right? So I think this is one of the ways that I think corporate are adapting, right? How real, we all don't know, right? Because in the end, they can still go back to the fact that, hey, you might as well buy you out, right? But the reality is that I think everybody is adapting to the new environment.
I think this is your point is okay. If the acquirer with a good valuation is fine, it's okay.
Oh, we are not the only pot in the world, if that's your worry. There are other pots, you know.
Because it's so domain specific, and you have access to such a scarce resource, which is the ports and deployments, that you know the startups are so beholden to you, and startups might not be at a point where they become successful and they can get bought over. You will be able to figure out, given your domain knowledge, whether this is going to be adopted. So you probably know better than the startups whether they're going to be successful, and you can make an offer even before the startups think they are good. Because once they are successful, they might say, we don't need you.
Yeah.
But if you're smart, you won't let that happen. You will buy in much early on.
It's a very fair point, but we fund at the PC level, and the reason for that, the reason we work with so many IHLs, is because the LogTech industry is really just, LogTech word is just coined very recently. So the industry and the sector is still growing, so we're not at the stage where we're looking to buy and acquire companies for sale. We're really trying to generate interest and make more people aware that the LogTech industry is growing.
They're trying to embed themselves everywhere else.
Hmm?
They're trying to embed themselves everywhere else.
Now, it's also a cheaper way for PSA to get great work done, right?
Absolutely.
Because I think in Singapore, startups are a good way to recruit people at low pay where they actually feel good about themselves.
So you're actually giving away all the secrets here.
Because
you can also look the other way. I mean, common startup works in there. He gets to understand how the internal operations are working. I can always leave and do another startup, then I understand the ins and outs and sell to other parts. I can also transfer knowledge to other business because I understand the process and operations. It's also a loop, can be a loss for them because the guy with knowledge, he run away and forms another startup.
I guess the problem we have. I guess the problem we have in Singapore is that it's quite unique, where there are many organizations and the government will give us money. Right?
Yeah.
The issue is success. Right? Are there enough mentorship?
Yeah.
You know, are there enough working together with a smaller company to make a success? Our biggest problem we all have as startups, right, is that no big organization will buy anything from us.
That's
the biggest problem. Right? We may be the best thing since sliced bread, right? I say how many people? 20 only.
Yeah,
right. So that's one of the biggest issue.
Yeah, So it's good that PSA is taking it. Because it's very hard to get. My first class startup, I couldn't sell to any small company until I sold to the US in Quebec.
Yeah.
It's very hard.
I mean, the idea is that while there's a sixth area, right, the whole idea, I think, is also there's a blue sky opportunity. So Joe, the point is that they may not be totally saying no, right, but they just have to figure out whether how do they use it. Because to them, if they invest in you and they can't use it internally, they cannot really help. Right, that's the other part of it, right? No, it's just any money you get from anybody else, right? There's no additional benefit, you know, if let's say PSA doesn't really use it at all. So I think those are the areas that areas that they see, right, which I can't really share, is that it's really beyond the port operations, right? I mean, they're looking at the next generation. And whether are they really going to invest and incubate, we still don't know, right? But these are areas that they are looking at, which is fairly oddball out there.
Yeah, we're just reading after today about how Rolls-Royce is building autonomous ships, actually.
Yeah.
It'll be launched by in a few years, 2 years. That brings now ships. Don't really need people, it's fully covered up, so that you have to navigate to the port automatically.
Yeah.
You can imagine that.
I mean, if they are already looking at AGVs, right?
This is ships.
Yeah,
ships
so
are
ship
on
sea.
You
know, yeah.
So very interesting.
Interesting.
Most of the time, no work.
Are you looking into drones? I'm sure you must be.
To be very honest, we were very interested in drones, but we struggled to find a very strong use case in the port. Open for ideas, if you have drone expertise, let us know.
Okay, we have to get our pizza in next time by 12:30. Okay. So it's so we have to tell them, you know, if you can't give us by 12:30, order from somebody else. All right. So we have some more time before the pizza is here. Please stay on, right? Please ask any question, right? Next week, I have someone who is in artificial intelligence coming, right? And so we'll talk about AI, machine language, and stuff. In Singapore. I'll be taking off for 3 weeks, right? Out of which 1 week is a holiday. So there's two more weeks. So last week of April and first week of May. The first week of May is actually InnoFest, right? Which is an NUS event. Some people will go, some people will stay, but we will try to broadcast it anyway. So I have forced Vino to help me to volunteer, to help me actually host the session while I'm gone. But if you guys have speakers, and we already have some speakers in mind for 26, I think, 26, 27, and 3rd of May, right, let me know, right? I will, you know, see life from wherever I am and ask me no question to ask you guys.
I'll
get somebody else on 3rd May. Anybody volunteers on 3rd May, you know, to host a session. But if not, I think we'll close for the day and the pizza is just here. Wow. Okay, so the pizza is here. Right, so thank you very much for coming to share.
Thanks,
right, website.
Oh yeah.
Right, website is there. And you can contact me to put you in touch with the guys over at PSA UnBoxed. Thank you very much. Please hit for pizza.